Hello everybody, this is Billy Wilder. Today we're going to be talking about one of the real old-fashioned country stores. You know, country stores were a part of real lifestyle. They provided not only the things that farmers needed, that all the farmers' family needed, but a real social gathering. And today we're here at Broadwell Store at the corner of Grasshopper and Pool Road. James Broadwell started this store a long time ago, and we're here with his son, and he's going to be talking about some of the things he remembers here. We've got a store full of people who have been here for a long time, lots of times at night. Some of the stories that have been told in this building may have been true. I'm not real sure. But Harold, tell us a little bit about your dad, the store, and some of the things that you remember, if you will.
Well, I'll tell you a little bit about how it all started. Had a great uncle, daddy's uncle, which was John Griffin. And Uncle John lived on the hill up about a half a mile from here. And this was Uncle John's store. And Uncle John owned the land here around it. And Uncle John was quite a character. He was one of those old folks that used to keep a possum in the house to purge the possum, feed it, so he could then kill it and eat it. And I remember going to see Uncle John when Daddy and I would go back and forth to get a haircut in Knightdale. And Uncle John and Daddy had a business relationship, and Uncle John eventually told him that if Daddy would run the store for him and help look after him, that he would leave the store to Daddy. And that's how Daddy got it. Daddy started running the store in 1949. That's what I remember. I wasn't here then, but that's what I have been told. And he kept the store till Uncle John died. I think Uncle John died in about 1958, 59, I don't recall. And after, or when Uncle John died, he left Daddy the store in his will. Uh-huh. And when I was young, my mother and father, Daddy and Mama, and my sister Lynette and I lived across the Pool Road in the back of my Uncle Worth's house. And it's always been a family place and a community place. But that's how it got started, and we've had it ever since. And Daddy came out here up until September 2005 when he became ill.
At the time that he passed away, you just shut the door, and that was it.
That was pretty much it. We shut the door. We took a few things out, and took them to our homes for memory's sake.
Right.
But otherwise, it's pretty much the way it was when Daddy locked the door the last time.
Salt meat box is still back in the back, and the rook table is back behind the church pew. That's behind the old stove.
That's right. We used to sell fatback salted pork out of a meat box. It'd be a big slab, and you'd tell Daddy how much you wanted, and he would cut it, weigh it, wrap it, tie it up with string, and you'd buy it.
Right.
And there was a time when we sold just about everything that anybody around here might have to have to get along. And one of the few stores, of course, then the only grocery store I remember was 3 miles away in Knightdale, and that was Robertson's grocery store. But we had frozen meats, chickens, sausages, hot dogs, pork chops, all of that. We had potatoes, onions. Sometimes we'd sell fruit, apples, oranges, different things, nuts sometimes. Lots and lots of canned goods, a lot of dry goods, flour, cornmeal. Daddy always kept a 5-gallon bucket of molasses, which he continued to do well on into his later years, and everybody used to love to come out here and get a pint or a quart jar full of molasses.
He also had a roll of plow lines, I believe.
Yeah, he used to sell plow line when folks used to use mules, and I actually remember being behind a mule in a tobacco field, and there was a steel bar up on the rafters back there, and the plow line was on that on a big spool, and you'd tell him how much you wanted and he'd cut it off.
Right. R.B. Hopkins is probably the oldest guy in here that's been coming to the store. RB, tell us a little bit about some of the things that you remember. Hold it right close to you.
Well, one of the main things I remember was grinding sausage here for years. All of us in this community grew hogs. And James grind sausage for us every year that come. And we stand right here and we'd weigh it. And he would season it for all of us, any amount he wanted to do. And then he had a stove sitting here. We'd cook it and sample it, everybody to see how it was how the thing was going. And that went on for, I don't know how many years.
And if I could put in there, a word in there, people would come from 50 miles away for Daddy to grind their sausage.
Right.
He had a secret recipe, and I don't know what it was. But
I got it. I know what it was, but I got it.
But he used to put a little bit of Coca-Cola in his seasonings, and he'd put it in a paper sack with the sage and black pepper, salt. Shake it up good and put a little bit of Coca-Cola in it and work it all into the meat.
I think that James Pope has the grinder today. If they changed, so James started killing hogs some after James Gill quit.
Right.
And I still think he used that same grinder. And I don't know whether he used the same recipe or not, but I think he does. But he quit also too.
Good.
And, thank you.
You know, we got a crowd sitting around behind this stove. Probably some of the same crowd that a lot of the folks sat behind the stove are not here anymore. They passed on to their reward. But there's been a lot of tales told around the stove, Earl. And like I said, some of them might even have been true, but not very many, perhaps. But I know Billy Mark is probably one of the younger guys, not really the youngest guy in here, but he's been around here a long time. And he's told me a few tales that have drifted around the stove. And Billy, I'm gonna get you to share one or two of them with us.
Well, as you said, most of these tales may not be true, but I can mention a few that come to my mind. Is one night we were sitting in here and Rex Horn is sitting somewhere in here, and Reuben Bravel, and a lady come up to the door and said that there was a hog out over on 64 Highway, and it was trying to get in a restaurant that was over there. I think it was Barron's Restaurant. And so Reuben, Rex, and myself decided to go over there and see about that hog. They thought it might be Rex, as he was farming that area. So we went over there, and the hog would weigh about 400 pounds. But it was a real, well, gentle hog. You could touch it and that kind of thing. So we loaded it up in the back of a pickup truck at night and brought it over here to the store, asked around. Nobody didn't know anything about it. We carried it down to James's hog pen and put it in there until we could find out who it belonged to. Well, the next day, that hog broke out of that hog pen of James's and come up here, and James always left the door open in the daytime. Well, I happened to come up by that time, and I looked, and the hog was coming around and went right up the front doorsteps and come right on into the store. And James had to run the hog back out of the store. But it was a lot of other things that went on. I think Rex was telling about the night that some of the guys had some, used to take a carry around a pistol in the pocket, some little pistols. And they got to looking at them. And James said, you boys better watch out with those pistols. One of them might go off and somebody get shot. But everybody just kept looking. And so James was sitting back over here on this bench, and he had a pistol here that he used for protection in the store. And he carried it back there, and he stuck it under the bench right under where we were sitting. And he fired it right through the floor and scared everybody in his bed. The guns was all, everybody was trying to get the guns back in the pockets. And I thought to myself, It's a real unique place that you can shoot through the floor and not bother anything. But that's just a couple of the things that I remember. And it was many, many more. I enjoyed coming here at night and sitting around watching the older people play cards and talk about farming. And it was a real community store. I never called it Broadwell Store. I always called it James's or the store. And it was a real place that when James passed away and it was closed, it was a real different to not have a place to go. I asked James one time. I said, James, I said, you work out here. I said, do you even make minimum wage? He said, Billy, I don't even take in minimum wage. So he really didn't do it for the money.
Well, you know, a lot has been said, and Harold, one of the things that I have heard a lot was the kind of guy that your dad actually was. It seemed like that if somebody needed some credit, he gave him credit. He might not have got paid. In fact, when we looked at the book that was laying over there, there's still some accounts that are open.
That's true. The charge book is still over here beside the ad machine, and I've checked on some of these fellas sitting here today, and I'm going to have to speak to a couple of them on the way out. But Daddy never turned anybody away, and truth is, it bothered my mother some, but if you came in and you needed something, or you were a day laborer who had come to work on somebody's farm in the summer and you didn't have any money saved up yet and you were scratching to eat, Daddy would start a page in the book. And I don't think he ever turned a soul away that needed.
Right. The tradition of Broadwell's store is continuing, and sitting over here is Reuben. And Reuben, I believe, is the youngest brother of James. Is that right?
Right. And I'm going to walk over here
and talk to Reuben just a minute. He didn't know he was going to be on camera this morning, but he always looks good, so it don't bother. Reuben, you've started your own store and seems to be doing quite well. But tell us a little bit what some of the things that you remember in this store as you were growing up.
I remember I was a young boy and really I didn't have no money or nothing, but I could come down here and have a good time. And it didn't cost me too much.
Didn't cost you too much?
That's right.
Always could get some candy?
Oh, well, yeah. Always get whatever you wanted to get. Right. He had me a page in the book, too.
Everybody had a page in the book.
Everybody wanted one.
Well, a lot has changed since James was running this store, as far as the way stores are run and the amount of dollars it takes to get into store business and all the rules and regulations that you have to meet. And I know you've been through a lot of them in getting your store on Smithfield Road up and running.
Yeah.
But, you know, one of the things that's just so nice is when you come in a store like this, it kind of carries you back to many years ago when things were a lot simpler and a lot more fun, actually.
They really were.
And Reuben is sitting on the salt meat box back here right now. And that wasn't an unusual place to sit either, was it?
Oh, I sit here many a time.
Right. You know, if you look around the store, you can kind of see about the same thing that was in the store years ago. And well, like I say, Harold just shut the door and didn't take everything out. But there's moon pies, there's gas, and oil, honey buns, just Windex, Decon, about anything that you can think of has been in this store for sale. One of the things that I believe Billy was telling me that there's a toolbox back here in the back that James used to have sitting up at the front. And if you needed a big wrench, there was wrenches that you could borrow and bring back. The toolbox is about empty now, so some of those wrenches are probably still out in the community. You boys have got in them wrenches. James probably would wish that you'd bring them back home. But it's really an old-fashioned country store. You know, there's been a lot of stories told about some of the things that Grim and Pearl Jr. Experienced in this store. And Grim Jr., tell us a little bit about buying cigarettes.
Mr. Fowler, you could come in, he'd sell you one cigarette at a time. That was when I was smoking a little bit. And so Uncle James would sell me one cigarette at a time. It was 10 cents. And I don't ever recall being any cheaper than that. But you know, you could, Mr. Wiley, you could get an education over here at Uncle James' store. I remember Mr. Sproul Baker taught me how to plow up ditches. And I know that sounds simple, but there's an art to plowing there up a ditch. And it begins before you even get to the field, setting up the tractor and what have you. But Mr. Baker was in General Patton's army in World War II. And these World War II guys, if it weren't for them, we may not even be here. So that was the greatest generation, in my opinion. Uncle James got on me one time about the way I put a piece of wood in the heater there. I didn't put it in there right. I can't remember if it was supposed to go bark down or bark up, but at any rate, I remember he got on me. I didn't put it in there just right.
So the next time you knew how to put
it in. Next time I did put it in the way he wanted to put it, but I forgot how he said to put it in. Been so long. Thank you.
Well, there's a lot of stories about things that went on in and around this store. One of the things that someone was sharing with me was, and I believe, Marshall, that your daddy might have told this story about a fellow that caught the big bass, and it was a great big one, and he dressed it and took the head off, and then the next day he went fishing with somebody else, and he slipped his head on the hook, and told the guy that was fishing with him, you know, he had a big bite, and he jerked the thing and said he jerked his fish's big fish so hard that he jerked the head completely off. So that's the kind of stories that have been passed around this stove many times. Grim Jr., I do appreciate the fact that there was a lot of good learning. Solid stuff that you learned at Country Store years ago, and you learned it from people who had good experience and knew how to do whatever it was, farming or seasoning sausage or killing hogs or whatever it might have been. But Country Stores did provide a real good forum. And it was, I think, guys, one of the fun parts of Country Stores was just like y'all were doing around here a while ago, when you get around this stove, you hear laughter and you hear folks talking about all kinds of things, good, bad, and indifferent, some of which we probably wouldn't put on the air, but they have provided a real service over the years to the society in Eastern North Carolina especially. Harold, one of the things that your dad did, along with just being completely open and sharing with everybody, he was very involved in the Bethlehem Baptist Church, wasn't he? Tell us a little bit about that, if you will.
Well, for most of the time that I can remember, he was a deacon in the church. He was always really active in taking care of the parsonage. I can remember at his funeral, Reverend Robert Boone talking about when the nightlight went out down at the parsonage, and he was trying to get somebody to come fix it, and nobody came. And then later that day, Daddy came down there and took out his ladder and ran up the pole, replaced the bulb, and came on down. And one of the things about that is that Daddy was an amputee.
Right.
He was very close friends with J.W. Watkins. J.W. was Big Ed Watkins' younger brother, mm-hmm. or older brother.
Older brother.
Older brother. And Daddy and J.W. were riding on a motorcycle down Edenton Street in Raleigh, and a lady in a truck made an improper left turn and basically turned over them and ran over them on the motorcycle. And as a result, Daddy had to have his left leg amputated just below the knee. And my Uncle Clyde sitting over here, Clyde, I think that was when he was about 21, 22 years old, wasn't it?
Yeah, just when he got out of the Navy.
So he was quite young, but even then he farmed just as hard as everybody else in the community. He did for the church. He and R.B. and Spoil Baker, who was mentioned, and some of them were and are still active in the Bethlehem Church and in the community, looking after the graveyard and keeping up with the grave plots. And I know Daddy used to keep the maps of all the graves here in the store. And whenever anybody in the community passed away, Daddy would have to find out where the grave was supposed to be, and they'd go over and plot it out and arrange for the grave to be put where it needed to be.
Well, you know, the store and the church were very vital in what we have all known as the Bethlehem community. And the Bethlehem community was not named from, that I know of anything, but the church. It's Bethlehem Church Community, really. And the store sat here for a long time. It's kind of an icon in this part of the country. And as you mentioned, and somebody else mentioned too, it was referred to a lot of times as just the store or James's store. Down the road, about a half a mile, I guess, is Lee's store. And it was called,
Well, if folks were going to Paul Lee's, they would say they were going to Paul Lee's. But if they were coming here, it was just the store.
Right.
Or they were going to James's. And all the wives in the community knew what that meant if their husband said they were going to the store. Daddy used to have a telephone up on the wall by the front door. And he eventually took it out. He took it out for two reasons. The real impetus behind it was finally the phone company called him and said, "Well, Mr. Broadwell, you've got this telephone in your store and you're paying a residential rate, and we're going to have to start charging you for a business line." And his response to that was, "Well, just come take it out then, because I don't need it, and all it is for the wives to call and check on the husbands over here at night." And there was a time when you'd have twice as many people as are in here now. The place would be a thick blue haze of tobacco smoke, and you might have 15, 20 pickup trucks parked around the parking lot and around the store. When I started to practice law in Raleigh back in 1979, 80, I remember a paralegal finding out that I was connected to the store, and she was just amazed. She said that they called it the order of the truck because all the pickup trucks seemed to drive up and worship at this store. So it's had a little mystique to it too.
One of the things sitting around, you brought some fresh Coca-Colas in. There's been a lot of Coca-Cola drank in here and a lot of peanuts poured down the Coke bottle, hasn't it?
Sure has. And if I tell you another little story, I met a lady through some work I was doing at the Eastern Regional Center in Zebulon. And she was from the Zebulon area. And she found out who I was, and she later stopped by my office in Wendell and brought me 3 framed pictures. And she and her children used to stop here and visit with Daddy because she wanted her children to know what a real country store was. And she had taken pictures of Daddy and her children sitting on the bench in front of the store, and she framed them, and she made a frame for me out of the Coca-Cola bottle caps that were all out in the yard. Because when the drink box cap catcher got full, Daddy would just throw them out, and it was like having gravel.
Well, it paved the ride with their walkway, didn't it? Well, it's certainly been a pleasure visiting with everybody here, actually, and seeing the inside of James's store. It's been a while of saying, see you next time.